very happy this afternoon to have Jennifer Schneider speak to us. She's an assistant professor and concentration coordinator of the Psych Mental Health Nurse Practitioner Program at the University of New Mexico College of Nursing. And in addition to her teaching duties, she practices in an outpatient community setting. And over the past couple of years, with COVID wreaking havoc on all of our psyches, she's been supporting her patients in navigating through that with all its associated increase in anxiety and depression, substance use, social isolation, all those things that we've all been struggling with. So we're very happy to have you. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming today. Originally putting this presentation together, I titled it The Mental Health Impacts of the Pandemic. And one of the things that I have, that I realize now getting ready today is that hopefully we're really moving towards post-pandemic at this point. And I wish I had a new title for the presentation, because I think that we are still seeing a lot of mental health impacts from the pandemic that we're still dealing with in clinical practice today. So the emphasis today will be on what's happened over the pandemic itself, but also really thinking about the impacts that we're still seeing in clinical practice now. So I've been a nurse practitioner for 8 years. My clinical focus has always been with children, adolescents. I currently have a very small private practice where I see patients up to age 25. And then, of course, I'm the concentration coordinator of the Psych NP program at UNM. I have nothing to disclose today, and I'm very excited to be here. In terms of the objectives for today, we're going to talk about evaluating the impact of the pandemic on patient mental health and really take a lifespan approach to this, and then talk about how to implement treatments for patients with these behavioral health symptoms and disorders, and then talk and really bring in some of the recent literature that's emerging on the mental health impacts of the COVID pandemic. And one of the things that I think is interesting and challenging in looking at the literature is that at the moment, there's quite a few studies published on early pandemic, what we saw early on, the spike in mental health issues early on in the pandemic. And it's just now that we're starting to see some of the literature emerging about some of the longer term impacts of the pandemic. Grab my clicker here. Sorry. Oh, there we go. No. Doesn't want to move head. I can do this. This will work. Oh, maybe it won't. Ah, there we go. Old school. thank you. Is it? Oh. Ah, there we go. Thank you. Just a brief thank you. I'm going to present a little bit on some research that I was involved in at UNM, and these were some of the folks that I worked with on that project. It really doesn't like me. The clicker doesn't like me. All right, I'm going old school. So I also like to go old school holding on to my slides this way. So just to talk for a moment about the 50,000 foot view of how COVID has changed our lives. And these are just some of the ways that we know of. So of course, the deaths from COVID-19, the poor physical health outcomes, the social isolation, the increased poverty and job loss, the economic disruptions that we've seen, the lengthy school closures and the learning loss that students have experienced, the changing nature of work, which is something that we are still grappling with now. How much do we need to be in person? How much can we do remotely? How should that look post-pandemic? And then, of course, as you all very well know, the strain on our healthcare system and the strain on our healthcare workers. And of course, the shortages that we're seeing now in the healthcare workforce. So when you think about it, when thinking about something that has had such a profound impact and change to our lives, it's really not surprising that we see that these impacts have bled over into our mental health. And one of the things we like to talk about in psychiatry is that transitions and changes of any kind, even really positive things, you know, marriages or a birth of a baby, these bring about stress, bring about mental health impacts. And so when you're talking about something like COVID-19 that has brought a lot of negative impacts worldwide, you can easily see how that could have a negative impact on our mental health. All right, this is, so this, as I said, there's quite a bit of data out there about some of the early responses, early results of the COVID pandemic. And so this is a survey that was conducted in June of 2020. And this was some of the really early data that made people kind of sit up and say, wow, this is having a significant impact, measurable impact on our mental health. At the time, 31% of adults were expressing symptoms of anxiety or depression, 26 were expressing symptoms of trauma, 13% had said they were starting to use substances or increase their substance use, and 11% had seriously considered suicide. And how does that compare? How does that compare to before the pandemic? So this is now April to June 2019 to June of 2020. You can see in the top left corner that the rates of depression or anxiety in adults quadrupled in that year, from those two time periods. In the big one on the right here, you can see rates of trauma increased by 8 times in adults from what's thought to be the typical annual rate of trauma versus June of 2020. And then you can see with adolescents in this bottom left-hand column, the depression that they experienced, depression and anxiety that adolescents experienced during the pandemic, you can see that the numbers are quite high. 20% of adolescents 20% experienced anxiety and 25% experienced depression. One of the things that's really challenging when we think about adolescents and children is that we have seen a steady rise in these rates of anxiety and depression in adolescents over the last 15 years. And so COVID exacerbated that problem, but it really has been a problem that we are seeing much more of really over the past 15 years. And then in addition, we saw an even faster rise in the rates of kids who were experiencing and reporting self-harm or suicidal thoughts. And so that rise that we've seen during the pandemic appears to be continuing to rise throughout the pandemic and into the post-pandemic period, especially for kids and adolescents. So we see an increase of symptoms in anxiety and depression in the psychological response to disasters or traumatic events. So this is just to remind you that any traumatic event, this is very much the typical pattern that you see people experience. The traumatic event happens, you see initial distress. Some people who experience initial distress eventually will have an increase in anxiety, an increase in depressed mood. Some of those people who have those symptoms will have difficulty with sleeping. And then some of those people, a small percentage, will actually go on to develop PTSD. For those who do develop PTSD, those symptoms can end up being quite long-term. So this is just a reminder of that COVID, that this pattern that we're seeing in COVID on such a global scale that we see nationally is also really very much in line with the typical response that we see to traumatic events or disasters. So now let's move on to talking about some of these long-term impacts of the pandemic on mental health. So there's overall been a 27.6 percent increase in major depressive disorder, a 25.6 increase in anxiety disorders. And that would be a number of different anxiety disorders like generalized anxiety, social anxiety, obsessive compulsive disorder. They all fall into that group. We've seen an increase in suicidal thoughts in children and young adults and in healthcare workers. And of course, we've seen an increase in the level of stress that healthcare workers are reporting. Overall, women have been more likely to experience significant symptoms than men. Young people have been more likely to experience symptoms. And then the medically fragile have been more likely to experience symptoms. And that is hypothesized to be due to increased worry over contracting COVID and what and the risks associated with contracting COVID, and potentially an increase in isolation as folks who are medically fragile have been isolating for longer and potentially more intensely. So we have seen, when it comes to children, a significant, not only we've talked now about this increase in anxiety and depression that we've been seeing over the last 15 years, but some of the data that is available at this point is the increase in ER visits that we've seen for kids due to due specifically to self-harming behaviors or suicidal thoughts or suicide attempts. And that data has been able to be tracked in pretty much real time. And there has been a, and that is a trend that's been increasing as well, but there has been an even more sharper increase during the COVID pandemic. So what are we talking about? When we say anxiety and depression, what are the kinds of symptoms that you're most likely to see? What are we talking about? What are we talking about in your particular clinical practice? So let's talk a little more specifically about anxiety, depression, and PTSD. So depression, which in the DSM we define as major depressive disorder or dysthymia, you're most likely going to see sadness, irritability, and when irritability is especially common in kids and teenagers. Loss of interest in activities that people once enjoyed, changes in appetite. What's most common is an increase in appetite and sleep changes, skip that one. So most often you see an increase in sleeping during the day, a decrease in sleeping at nighttime, decreased energy, and decreased concentration. And one of the things that comes up a lot for folks who are practicing in pediatrics is families who come in and say, the school is saying maybe my kid has ADHD. And one of the things that's really important to consider is this potentially part of depression or anxiety versus actually being a diagnosis of PTSD. Then with anxiety disorders, of course, we mentioned there's a lot of different types, but overall, what you're seeing is an increase in uncontrollable worries, an increase in physical symptoms of anxiety, like restlessness, muscle tension, irritability again, decreased concentration again, and fear, especially what's most common and seems to be most common coming out of this pandemic, is a fear of social situations. Of course, panic and panic attacks, and that feeling of impending doom that often accompanies anxiety disorders. And then with PTSD, and now I'm thinking specifically about symptoms of chronic PTSD. So somebody who may have started to experience symptoms of PTSD earlier on in the pandemic, now it's been potentially a year, 2 years, and they are experiencing these ongoing symptoms of PTSD. Hyperarousal is one of them. A lot of somatic complaints like head and body aches, poor ability to regulate emotion. So increased anger, increased aggression. Sometimes in my world, we get people sent to us where the concern is perhaps this is bipolar disorder. And so thinking about chronic PTSD as a possibility and the differential is really important. And then negative views of themselves and the world and really the future. So what are the drivers that are increasing mental illness? And so we know some of these that stressors that have been really common during the pandemic: low social support, isolation, quarantine, loneliness, physical and mental exhaustion, especially problematic with healthcare workers, poor physical health, and sleep disturbance. And there has been a significant increase in the use of sleep aids among all populations since the pandemic started. So I was involved in some research at UNM during the pandemic. We created a UNM pandemic screening tool, which was available electronically to all UNM faculty, staff, and students at all the campuses. And the purpose of the study was to better understand the mental health needs of the UNM community. What we did was we used a combination of established measures to measure depression, anxiety, stress, PTSD, substance use. And then we also asked some additional questions. And why I'm bringing this today is because we developed something we called the cumulative COVID impact score. And this was looking at some of those stressors that people experienced during the pandemic and looking at what were the most common stressors and how, and a kind of crude way of looking at how to measure how much stress people were experiencing. So these were all of the questions we asked in the COVID impact score, things like I lost my job, or I'm an essential worker, or I've experienced food, housing, or healthcare insecurity, that I've experienced suffering due to isolation. We asked if someone I know had contracted COVID, which now, of course, you'll see our numbers were fairly low on that. And now, of course, I'm not sure any of us don't know somebody who's contracted COVID. So this is what we found. These were the items that we saw with the highest frequency. The most common one, it probably won't seem like a surprise, was experiencing isolation. Gaining new responsibilities to care for others was next. And then someone I cared about contracted COVID was next. As I said, I think that one would probably be even higher at this point. And that I experienced financial difficulty. Then we looked at how many of these people reported. So there were 961 total participants in our study, and about 13% of them said that COVID didn't impact them at all. Items from the COVID impact score. And then what was most common is that people reported 1 to 3 of these measures, and that was really about 60% total of the people that we surveyed. And then we also asked about how COVID has impacted your mental health. So this is a little bit funny slide. I apologize. It's a little bit out of order, but you can see there's negatively, very negatively, but then not at all positively or very positively. And so 80% of folks in this survey reported that the pandemic negatively or very negatively impacted their mental health. And this question was adapted from some very common physical health questions that are asked about rating your overall health and rating the impact of a particular event on your overall health that have been really good indicators, reliable indicators of physical health. So one of the things I was asked about to talk about today when I was asked to talk about COVID mental health was to talk a little bit about long haul COVID and the mental health impacts that we've seen about this. This is definitely one of those areas of emerging literature where we're really still not, there isn't a lot of firm answers as to what's going on here. But I'd like to talk a little bit about kind of where the state of the science is at this point. One of the things we know with long haul COVID is that it can occur, symptoms can occur with mild to severe infection. And figuring out exactly who's going to develop long haul COVID has been very difficult to determine. There are a number of hypothesized causes of the of these symptoms, of the mental health symptoms, and none of those them have been yet ID'd as the definitive cause. So it's possible we're talking a combination of these things. It's possible we're talking about something else that hasn't been discovered, or it's possible it really is more one of these things than the others. So one of them hypothesized is it's an immune or autoimmune response. It has been hypothesized to be related to oxygen deficiency to the brain while sick with COVID, and then damage to neurons that resulted. It's been talked about as a viral assault on the neurological system, potentially from the COVID virus itself. And then it's also been talked about as potentially being due to social isolation. And so it's really not a direct biological cause, but the social isolation that has occurred due to COVID and due to the long haul symptoms has then led to the development of the mental health symptoms. So what have we seen in terms of these symptoms of long haul COVID? Depression, anxiety, insomnia, you can see these are really similar to what we're seeing across the population, decreased concentration, and then psychosis, which I'm going to talk about a little bit more because I know that's one of those things that's very frightening to hear about. And then PTSD, which has actually been linked only to severe infection, often to folks who've been hospitalized. Quite a few people who experience hospitalization, ICU stays, will develop PTSD symptoms or acute stress reaction to that hospital stay. So to talk for a moment about psychosis. So new onset psychosis with COVID infections. So we're talking about COVID-19 patients who either have an active infection or recently post-infection who are demonstrating a first onset of psychotic symptoms, meaning they've never had psychosis before. And specifically that's talking about hallucinations and delusions. So some of these cases have been eventually attributed to acute delirium. And we know with delirium, folks can experience hallucination and delusions. And for many of those folks, the psychosis resolves with the delirium, but not all. Some cases are thought to potentially be due to primary psychosis. So in that, what we're talking about is we know, for example, that folks who develop schizophrenia likely have a genetic predisposition to schizophrenia and fit into that diathesis stress model where they have this genetic disposition and then they have these assaults on the brain, stressors that they experience, and that then leads to the experience of, to the development of schizophrenia. And so the theory is that COVID itself might have been one of those triggers that has triggered a first break in somebody that might have developed psychotic symptoms anyway. And then some cases are thought to be a secondary psychosis. So this would be psychosis that's due to an unidentified process of COVID-19, that there's the virus is somehow attacking the brain, or metabolic changes, or even potentially some of the treatments that we're using for COVID that may have a side effect of leading to some psychotic symptoms. Symptoms do typically resolve within weeks usually with low doses of antipsychotic medications. And I think that's really important to note. I've had this come up when I was working inpatient with children and adolescents who had drug use that led to psychotic symptoms, is that families often, and sometimes providers, wouldn't want to treat that psychosis with medication, hoping that it would just resolve on its own, and hoping that it was short term. And what we found in dealing with the patients experiencing that kind of psychosis is that treating with usually often low dose antipsychotic medications can actually speed up their recovery. So it looks like that's true for psychosis with long haul COVID as well. So you know, so I would say not to hesitate to treat those patients with antipsychotics for a brief period, and warning families that a brief period often means 3 to 6 months, not a week, because often those symptoms aren't resolving even in a short acute admission stay. So now what I'd like to do is move on to talking about treatment. And I'll talk first about treatment for long haul COVID. So first of all, it's really unclear how long these symptoms will last. And this is the kind of thing that we really aren't sure about in the literature yet. And there's quite a bit of research happening on this at this point. So far, it appears that it is safe to treat patients with usual psychiatric medications, and that it also makes sense to treat patients according to DSM-5 criteria and symptom severity. In other words, you might say this person has long-haul COVID and is experiencing depression or anxiety, and you would actually then also want to give that person a diagnosis of major depressive disorder. If the symptoms were moderate to severe, which are the symptoms that are most amenable to treatment with psychotropic medications, then you would potentially then want to initiate treatment with a psychotropic medication. So basically treating these symptoms as you would treating any patient who's walking in with significant anxiety or depression. So with that in mind, that really what we're talking about here is treating people using our normal processes, I'd like to review that a little bit. I hope this isn't entirely review to all of you, and you'll find a couple of pearls in here. But really what we're talking about is the typical treatment that we use now for folks with anxiety and depression. As I'm sure you all know, being able to take even just a couple minutes to sit with the patient and listen to what's going on can work wonders for people. I like to have a few brief interventions that I have in my repertoire that are really very quick to teach. And in my handouts that I provided for today, I actually provided you with a description of a number of these brief interventions. I like some of the breathing exercises. I like 4x4 breathing because it's really easy to remember. Breathe in for 4 counts, hold it for 4 counts, breathe out for 4 counts, hold it for 4 counts, and repeat, ideally for 4 minutes. And then belly breathing, which is very simple. It's hand on the belly, hand on the chest, and focus on moving your belly and not moving your chest while breathing. Mindfulness exercises, and those can be simple things that I included a walking meditation in here. And also things like 5 senses exercise. So that's often people like to use that when they're starting to feel overwhelmed with anxiety or slipping into a panic attack. So that can be things. So what that is, thinking of 5 things that you can see, 4 things that you can touch, 3 things that you can hear, 2 things you can smell, and 1 thing you can taste. And some people do it by right here in your place. What do I see right now? What do I hear? What do I smell? And others will, especially with kids, they like to go find things that they can touch, find things that they can see and hear. And either way is fine. And then another thing, just to point out that I have had so many patients in my practice who have said, my primary care provider was so good on this. They gave me a script for exercise. They gave me a script for self-care. They gave me, they sent me off and told me to do those things. I have had so many patients who are like, they got it. This is what they gave me. So even things as simple as that, of course, script writing isn't as simple as it used to be. For those kinds of things, isn't as simple as it used to be since everything's electronic. But really giving people permission and encouraging them to build those things into their everyday can help, especially with mild symptoms. Then again, I'm sure not completely new to you, but in thinking about diagnosis and treatment, of course, we want to think about evaluating the symptoms. So I included here a number of really common measures. And frankly, they are common because they are very, they're well validated, they're reliable, and so they really are encouraged to use, and they're quick. So I included in the handout paper copies of all of these scales, and then additionally, in the reference list for the PowerPoint, you can find electronic versions. I know a lot of you have these built into your EMRs as well for patients to use. These are all in the public domain, and really all very good tools. So the GAD-7 is used for people over age 12, and a score of 10 to 14 indicates moderate anxiety, and 15 plus indicates severe anxiety. PHQ-9, again, is approved for children 12 and older and adults, and moderate depression is 10 to 14, moderate severe depression is 15 to 19, and 20 plus is severe depression. The PCPTSD isn't quite as well known. That's a tool that's out of the VA. And that's a tool that's been used with adults. And it's looking for some of the most common PTSD symptoms. The cutoff is either answering yes to 3 or 4 of the 5 questions. There's an argument about whether it should be 3 or 4. Seems like women, the cutoff might need to be 3, and for men, it might need to be 4. And then the CAGE aid, so that's those 4 CAGE questions about substance use, and if you add the additional questions about alcohol use, and if you add the additional questions about drug use, then it's the CAGE aid. And those, of course, are very quick questions, and the cutoff there is if someone's answering yes to 2 of the 4 questions. And then I don't have a really great tool for sleep, but what I always like to do when I'm evaluating sleep is to ask about problems falling asleep, staying asleep, waking too early, and describing a typical night of sleep. So in terms of psychiatric medications, first of all, you want to be following with the best practices of using psychiatric medications for any instance. So we're thinking specifically about patients who are experiencing moderate to severe symptoms. And then we're thinking about patients who are saying that this is significantly impacting their lives. And that's the time when you might want to consider psychiatric medication. And what I included here was where to start the medications, and some of the most common and I think often first line treatments for anxiety and depression. So first line include fluoxetine, which is approved for age 7 for OCD or 8 for depression. With children, I generally start at 10 milligrams. Adults, you can start at 10 or 20 milligrams. Escitalopram is approved for 12 plus. And with kids, I usually start at 5, and adults, you can start at 5 or 10. And then sertraline, which is FDA approved only for adults, starting 25 to 50 milligrams. And then paroxetine, which is FDA approved only for adults and also has been implicated as one of those medications that can cause increase. We know the black box warning, all antidepressants can cause an increase in suicidal thoughts in people under age 25. Paroxetine specifically was involved in some of those very early studies where this symptom was found. And so it's really contraindicated in kids, but can be a very helpful medication for adults. And then second line treatment, again, bupropion we mostly use only with adults. It does not have FDA approval for children. Starting dose, I like to just use the XL and start at 150 milligrams once a day. For others, I find bupropion especially useful if folks are experiencing depression versus anxiety. People experiencing anxiety can sometimes become more anxious on bupropion, especially if they're taking it as a monotherapy. So if the SSRI is not working well for someone, switching to an SNRI can be helpful if they're also experiencing anxiety. And so some of those are venlafaxine starting at 37.5 to 75 milligrams or duloxetine, which is approved for anxiety in children 7 plus, starting at 20 to 40 milligrams once a day. Then I think one of the old school ideas when you were starting patients on an antidepressant is we all know that these take a long time to work for people. So sometimes it was suggested that we give people a benzo to kind of help them get through for a few weeks until they started experiencing relief from the SSRI. I really discourage that. I think that of course, we know about the concerns about dependence with benzo use. So here are some other ideas of what you could add along with an SSRI to help either coping with acute anxiety symptoms or for helping with anxiety symptoms while you're waiting for the medication to kick in, the SSRI or SNRI to become effective. So that includes hydroxyzine, often 10 to 25 milligrams, either twice a day or at nighttime. That's approved for 6+ for anxiety. Gabapentin, 100 to 300 milligrams, either BID or TID. That is approved for kids starting at age 3, specifically for seizures. So it has FDA approval as an adjunct treatment for seizures. And then buspirone, 5 to 15 milligrams. There isn't a ton of good literature supporting its use in children, and it doesn't have FDA approval in children, but it can be helpful for adults especially. And then, of course, with insomnia, I always think of myself like putting my most nursey hat on when I'm talking to people about insomnia, because really at the core of it all, we need to be thinking about good sleep hygiene. And good sleep hygiene, I mean, research indicates that good sleep hygiene works as well as Ambien for helping people with insomnia. And so I approach it. I don't want people to feel like I am not taking seriously their concerns, but also trying to remind them about what good sleep hygiene is and how they might be able to make a couple little changes to improve their sleep hygiene. Things like sleepy time teas are helpful. Melatonin, I like melatonin in really, really low dosage. I have people using a half to 1 milligram at nighttime, and that can be helpful for some. Some people don't find it very helpful at all, but I think it's worth a try. Diphenhydramine for 25 to 50 milligrams, especially for occasional use. Then some medications that are approved specifically 18+, trazodone, which I generally start at 25 or 50 milligrams. And one thing to watch out with trazodone is the risk of priapism in males, which seems to be especially problematic in teenage males. So I tend to avoid that medication with that population. And then doxepin, which especially if you can use the newer dosing of doxepin at very low doses, the 3 or 6 milligrams, sometimes that's not covered by insurance, but that is often can be very helpful for sleep when other things haven't worked. And all of those medications are not leading to a physical dependency like you would see potentially with the Z drugs or regular use of a benzo. And then finally, referring for psychiatric evaluation, which I say with a little bit of a smile because I know that I know that we have a challenge here in New Mexico with having enough psychiatric providers and getting people in a timely manner. And I know that the folks in primary care are really bearing the brunt of that burden. But I did include for you in the handouts a long list of referrals. And what I did is I bugged a bunch of my friends for where, you know, what they had in terms of referral lists. So there's a list of some specialty clinics here in New Mexico. There's a list of therapy only for adults, med management clinics for adults, and then child specific in all of those areas. And then also someone sent me some referrals sources for folks who are homeless. So I'm hoping that those will be useful to you as I said, the lists are fairly updated. So, you know, hopefully at least for now, they'll be useful to you in your clinical practice. So that is it for all of my presentations. Thanks so much for being here, and for those of you here in person. I'm happy to take any questions that you have. Hopefully we still have a few minutes.
We do have a few minutes for questions, but if you have any, we'd like you to use the microphone because we have people online that otherwise can't hear.
So one of the things I've encountered is when someone had acute COVID and then they were treated with steroids and it made their psychosis worse.
Yes.
And so basically the very thing that is treating the person for the COVID, which is extremely important to get on top of, actually made the psychosis worse.
Yes. 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 And, you know, we see steroidal psychosis as well, even as a new symptom, not just worsening existing. Yeah, absolutely. Yep. And that's, you know, and that's one of the challenges. And then some of these new drugs, we really are not sure if there are potential mental health impacts because it's they're too new.
Anyone else have any questions? Let me check the chat box real quick. There weren't any there a minute ago. No, if there's anyone listening on Zoom, if you have any questions, if you put them in the chat box, I can relay those. Okay, it looks like there aren't. Thank you so much. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.